don't fall asleep. Now we'll just see how dulcet my tones really are. See what happens. I gotta say, it is a blessing. It's just cool to look out and see the chairs. I mean, it just looks so much different. So praise God for that. We are in Ezekiel 34 and 35 tonight. 35 is actually kind of a short little chapter, and we'll try to see how much we can get through tonight. But chapter 34 and 35 tonight. So open your Bibles. If you don't have one with you, there should be one in the chair in front of you, on the pocket, not on the floor anymore. So, yay, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for tonight. Thank you for bringing us here. Lord, I thank you, as we were praying earlier, that you are our good shepherd. You sought us out. You saved us. I thank you, Lord, for that. I thank you for how you described yourself that way to Israel. Thank you for how you not only loved them and sought them, but you rose up in their defense. And so, Lord, we pray that you would teach us these things, and as we would look at your word, in Jesus' name, amen. We've said it before, there's some words that just don't seem to go together. The classic example is jumbo shrimp, because how can shrimp be jumbo? They're shrimp. It doesn't make any sense at all. But there's other examples. What we have up here on the title, for lack of a better word, shepherd and avenger, those don't really seem to go together either. What do those things have in common? One's a peaceful person in the pasture, caring for livestock. The other is a warrior, unless you're thinking of the trademarked Marvel comic book characters and movie. But even that, it wouldn't seem to go with the shepherd very well. But sometimes these things do come together. Humanly speaking, when we're talking about shepherd and avenger, that could describe the human resume of King David, right? His whole career. He began as a shepherd, as a musician even from that, and becomes one of the mightiest warriors in Israel's history. And of course, as he rose up to being king, he was able to judge and avenge his people, righteous king of the land. But even David is a mere shadow of what comes together in the Lord God. For his people, God promised to be both shepherd and avenger. He promised to tend his flock, and he promised to rise up in their defense. His love, as we're going to see, is what motivated him to do both. Now, before we get there, contextually speaking, where we are in the book of Ezekiel, this book is in a little bit of transition. We can't say for certainty when these prophecies were given. The last solid date we got was in chapter 32, verse 17. All right, and if you recall, that was April 27, 585, basically. So Jerusalem had fallen at that time. Whether or not these following oracles came exactly in at the same time, we don't know. But that said, when we're talking about how these oracles were collected and put in the book of Ezekiel, The focus of these collected oracles has returned primarily to Israel, because it had focused a lot on their Gentile neighbors, how God was going to judge them. And God, once again, we saw last week, spoke of the judgment for his own people, and he demonstrated that his judgment's fair. Despite their protest to the contrary, his judgment is absolutely fair. So now, as we get into chapter 34, he's going to speak of a specific segment of his people that will be judged, the rulers. And then he once again briefly turns to some of their neighbors, as we'll see, Mount Seir or Edom, all right? So what we find here is really, in the book of Ezekiel, the last major word about the near-term judgment of God. But even as we'll see here, a lot of this does look forward to the future. As the good shepherd, he's going to bring his people home. As the avenger, he's going to rise up on their defense. So chapter 34 is all about him being the good shepherd. And first, he starts out giving woe judgment to the evil shepherds, verses 1 through 10. Verse 1 says, "And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God of the shepherds, Woe to the shepherds of Israel who feed themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flock?" Okay, who are the shepherds? We're not talking about literal shepherds here. These are the leaders of Israel, the kings, the elders, even the priests and the false prophets of the land, all of the people who had responsibility for leading God's people according to God's covenant. If they were entrusted with leadership, they were made and fell into the account here of a shepherd. Now, earlier, if you recall in our study of Ezekiel, God had already spoken a word against Israel's leaders. In chapter 22, we saw several verses about that, verses 23 through 31. And we say, well, why does he have to say it all over again? Well, because it was worth saying. You know, the crimes of the kings of Israel and Judah that had not been ignored by the ultimate king of Israel, Almighty God. God knew what they had done. He knew what he had in store for them, and they needed to know it as well, you know, unless they're going to get too comfortable as time goes by. Oh, judgment hasn't come yet. God's saying, yes, it will. You've got a specific judgment coming for you. And the basic message that he says here is, woe to the shepherds who have been shepherding themselves. Shepherds, that word is actually taken from a verb. That means to pasture or to graze. You know, the ones that are pasturing the sheep, the one that are caring for the sheep. But the only people the pastors, the shepherds were taking care of were themselves. They were supposed to be looking after others, not looking after themselves. Their position of leadership was, you know, entrusted responsibility. It's not a privilege. Oh, you know, God gave me wealth. God gave me this position so I can do with it as I please. But what was it they had done? God says that they had acted selfishly. They had taken the best for themselves without any regards for others. Look at verse 3. You eat the fat and clothe yourselves with the wool. You slaughter the fatlings, but you do not feed the flock. The weak you have not strengthened, nor have you healed those who were sick, nor bound up the broken, nor brought back what was driven away, nor sought what was lost. But with force and cruelty you have ruled them. He's talking here about neglect, and he's talking about outright abuse of power. You know, God has accused Israel's shepherds of acting precisely the opposite of how a normal, humane shepherd might have acted. Not only were these leaders unloving and without compassion, they were downright cruel. In other words, they're not just passive with their evil, allowing it all to go by. No, they're active with it. These men had the responsibility of caring and leading God's people, and they trashed it. And God, I should say, always takes note of those who abuse his people. You know, it's not for zero reason that James exhorts teachers to be mindful whether or not you want to be a teacher, because you face a stricter judgment. James 3, verse 1. We are, speaking as a teacher, all under shepherds for the great true shepherd of the flock of God. We all are his people, and this church, and hopefully every church around, is his church, not any pastor's church. And pastors and leaders, no matter what title they may have, how many letters they have after their name, they do not have the right to selfishly abuse the people of God. And those, and you see it all the time, who enrich themselves off of tithes and offerings will be called to account. Those who teach false doctrine to make life easier for themselves, and that so often happens, will be judged. Those who manipulate the people in the pews to do every whim of the person in the pulpit will find themselves on the receiving end of God's anger. And that's not something to take lightly. Now, if any of this sounds familiar, God calling the evil shepherds to account, is because if you're with us when we went through the book of Jeremiah, God gave a similar word to Jeremiah, which perhaps was around the same time frame that God gave this to Ezekiel even. But we read this in Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 1 and 2. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord God of Israel, against the shepherds who feed my people, you have scattered my flock, driven them away, and not attended to them. Behold, I will attend to you for the evil of your doing, says the Lord. See, as with Ezekiel, God will go on here to say that he's going to promise a better shepherd. In fact, through Jeremiah, he promises Jesus, the son of David, and we'll see that again here in a moment. So whether he's talking to the Jews in Jerusalem through Jeremiah at the time, or after Jerusalem fell to the Jews that are in exile with Ezekiel, God gives them a word of comfort. He knew the abuse that they had endured at the hands of their leadership, and he would act in judgment. Verse 5. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and they became food for all the beasts of the field when they were scattered. My sheep wandered through all the mountains and on every high hill. Yes, my flock was scattered over the whole face of the earth, and no one was seeking or searching for them. God's sheep were lost because of the action, or as we saw also, inaction of the shepherds. And three times here, God describes his people as being scattered, could be translated dispersed throughout the earth. And that's exactly what happened. The people were removed from their land. They were sent into what we often call the diaspora, the dispersion through the nations. Technically, God says you had no shepherds. Technically, they did have shepherds. He's, you know, accusing them of woe, or telling them, proclaiming woe upon them. It wasn't like they had shepherds, no shepherds at all. It was that they didn't have any real shepherd. They didn't have any good ones, right? They didn't have anyone that acted like a shepherd ought to have acted towards them. And that left them vulnerable. That left them defenseless. And God is always compassionate towards sheep without a shepherd. Remember when Jesus looked out onto the multitudes and he had compassion on them for that very reason, told us in Matthew 9:36. They were like sheep without a shepherd, and he was moved on their behalf. His compassion for them, he was moved on their behalf because they had no one. Now, was it saying that they were absolutely leaderless? Well, of course not. Jesus was in the middle of his Galilean ministry. A few verses before that talks about he was going from synagogue to synagogue as he goes to the various towns and cities. And so, obviously, there were rabbis there. There were Pharisees there. If you went down to Jerusalem, you had the Sanhedrin Council, the leadership. You had the priests and all the rest. It wasn't like there were nobody at all serving in positions of leadership. It's that the leaders they had led them away from God. And so when it really came down to brass tacks, they had no real shepherd. They were abandoned. They were abandoned. And God is very compassionate to those who have been abandoned, but God is not compassionate to those who abandon his sheep. Look at verse 7. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As I live, says the Lord God, surely because my flock became a prey, my flock became food for every beast of the field, because there was no shepherd, nor did my shepherds search for my flock, but the shepherds fed themselves and did not feed my flock. Therefore, O shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against the shepherds. I will require my flock at their hand. I will cause them to cease feeding the sheep, and the shepherds shall feed themselves no more. For I will deliver my flock from their mouths, that they may no longer be food for them. And so what was the result of these evil actions of the poor shepherds, the evil shepherds? It was death. God's people died because of them. Because of the sin of the kings, what happened? Well, people and the citizenry, they were led into idolatry. Because of the ineptness of the priests, what happened? Well, the people did not seek revival. Because of the leadership in Israel that was engaging in sin, that led the people of Israel into further sin. Now, that doesn't excuse any individual Israelite from their own individual action, but we cannot ignore the influence that the leadership had upon them. People died because of their callous neglect and abuse. That was the very reason why the Babylonians and others came in. That's the very reason why so many people died in the streets. And so God promised to judge them. He would remove these shepherds from their place of leadership, and he would deliver his sheep from them as if it was a sheep being delivered from the mouth of a wolf, because that's exactly what these so-called shepherds had turned into. So that was woe to the shepherds, but he did promise a work of restoration starting in verses 11 through 16. Verse 11 says, for thus says the Lord God, indeed I myself will search for my sheep and seek them out. As the shepherd seeks out his flock on the day he is among his scattered sheep, so will I seek out my sheep and deliver them from all the places where they were scattered on a cloudy and dark day. God seeks his sheep. The other shepherds, they weren't really shepherds. So God himself would lead them. God would be their shepherd. He would find his sheep wherever they had scattered to, wherever they were in the world. He would deliver them from their troubles. And just let's consider that and chew on that for a little moment. Had those individual Jews sinned against God? Well, yes, they had. We just made that point. They had been failed by their leadership, but they did engage in sin of their own. But God still loved them. And he still desired their restoration. He still desired their regathering. God knew where they were, and he vowed to seek them out and to save them. That is exactly what he does through Jesus. What do we know from Jesus? He said, I have come so I can seek and save the lost. Luke 19, verse 10, we just sang about it. He even used the picture of a shepherd to describe what it looks like. If a shepherd, he said in the parable, has 100 sheep, one goes missing, what does he do? He goes out, he leaves the 91, one goes to find the one, and when he finds it, he rejoices, Luke 15. Jesus sought us out. You know, we so often talk about seeking Christ, and there's an element of truth to that, absolutely. But ultimately, it's Jesus who seeks us. We were scattered from him, and he knew exactly where we were. He called us by name, and he carried us home to himself. And no matter what we had done, no matter where we had gone, he still loved us, he still knew us, and he still saved us. And praise God, that's the wonderful good news of the gospel, because that same grace that we've experienced as believers, that's available to every man, woman, and child on the planet. Any person who feels the Spirit pull, you know, their spirit pulled by God, I should say, well, that's a person who's hearing the call of Jesus to be their shepherd. He is still seeking, he's still calling, and people can still respond. What's involved with God's work of seeking? Well, we see this in verse 13. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries. I will bring them to their own land. I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, in the valleys and all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them in good pasture, and their fold shall be on the high mountains of Israel. There they shall lie down in a good fold and feed in good rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I'll feed my flock. I'll make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek what was lost and bring back what was driven away, bind up the broken and strengthen what was sick, but I will destroy the fat and the strong and feed them in the judgment. God, first off, gathers his sheep. God gathers his sheep. He knows where they are, no matter where they've gone. He gathers them back together. When it came to, you know, when it was time to regather Israel as a nation, God did not have to send out search parties all over Babylon to find out where they were. No, he regathered him. We'll see this actually in the book of Revelation as well. When it comes time to number the tribes of Israel, he knows exactly which ones need to be numbered. He knows where there are. By the way, there are no lost tribes of Israel. God knows everyone by name. He gathers his people. Second, God feeds his sheep. He provides for them. He gives them what they needed. The evil shepherds, we saw, fed themselves. God selflessly gives. He feeds. He provides. He ensures that his people get what they need, whether that's the bread of life in Christ Jesus himself or the ongoing feeding of the bread of his word. He gives us. He feeds us. Third, he protects his sheep. When God makes his sheep to lie down, we saw that picture a few times there. Well, the idea is that they're lying down in safety. Sheep that feel danger around, well, they're not lying on the ground. They're on their feet, ready to run. God's sheep, he says, well, he can make them lie down. We're in the hands of Jesus. And when we are in his hands, we're in good hands. We're in safe hands. And we can take comfort in that. God heals his sheep. He says, those who are broken find strength in the Lord. You know, we see this throughout the Bible where we're talking about the people of the Old Covenant. We're talking about the people of the New Covenant. All of God's people find healing in his grace. Emotional wounds are tended. Old scars are healed over. Those who are weak are made strong. Our God heals. Then we see here, finally, God vindicates his sheep. We'll see later on, you know, the fat versus the strong. The fat were the bullies. They were the bullies over the people of Israel. And God would see that they received their justice. Those who abused God's people would answer to God himself. As you go through this list of everything God does as a shepherd, does it sound familiar to any particular psalm that stands out? And most of us, it reminds us of Psalm 23, and it probably should, because some of these same things are said. Psalm 23, 1 through 4, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Well, that's almost point for point what we had here with God speaking through Ezekiel. David knew, this is Psalm of David, he knew the personal shepherding of the Lord God. Israel received the promise of it through the prophecies of Ezekiel, the prophecies of Jeremiah and others. We received this same promise through Jesus Christ. He is our good shepherd. And that's exactly what he goes on to promise through the last part of this chapter, verses 17 through 24. Verse 17 says, "And as for you, O my flock, thus says the Lord God, behold, I shall judge between sheep and sheep, between rams and goats." Now, before we get too far on this, let's see what this is and what this is not. And different scholars have different opinions on this. This sounds very similar to what Jesus later says on to his disciples about the judgment between the sheep and goats. And it would not be improbable in the slightest that Jesus is, you know, kind of alluding to this text when he's teaching that in the Olivet Discourse. But please, we need to notice a very important distinction. The judgment Jesus talks about in Matthew 25 is between the sheep and the goats. Here, God's judgment in Ezekiel 34 is between sheep and sheep, between rams and goats. See, Matthew 25 distinguishes two different animals altogether. Ezekiel 34 distinguishes between animals of the same basic kind. The overall context of Jesus' judgment, if we pick that up in its context, would show that this is what happens at the end of the Great Tribulation when Jesus judges the nations of the world. Matthew 25, 32. Those nations of the world who survived the Great Tribulation will enter the Millennial Kingdom. The context here of the judgment in Ezekiel 34 is between Jew and Jew, those who followed God and those who led people away from God. This is different. This is the continued judgment of God against the evil shepherds of his people. So it's a different judgment than what Jesus was talking about. This is judging those evil shepherds. They were shepherds, but they're sheep as well, right? They're part of God's flock, and they were rebellious. So God's very capable, he says, of determining which sheep are his. He knows which ones have hearts that truly follow him and which ones do not. He knows his humble sheep, and he knows who abuses his humble sheep. And on the outside, they might look the same, but God knows what's really on the inside. And that same concept, of course, not just true with Israel, but it's true with all of us. He knows, God does, who truly follows him. He knows who's truly a Christian, who just appears to be one on the outside. You know, when we look at this passage, perhaps a better analogy isn't the judgment between the sheep and the goats, but the judgment between the wheat and the tares, Matthew 13. You know, those are very similar looking plants. They look almost identical, but only one's good for harvesting. And so it's like judging between sheep and sheep. God knows the difference between wheat and tares. He knows the difference between who's his and who's not. Jesus said at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, will actually enter the kingdom of heaven. A lot of people are going to find themselves in the same point. Well, I prayed a prayer. I went forward. I got baptized. I raised my hand. I signed a card. I did. But you didn't really have faith. Someone might appear to be a Christian on the outside without having true faith on the inside. God knows. And God can discern the difference. Best thing for us to do in the meantime is like Peter said, make sure, or he says, make your call and election sure. 2 Peter 1:10. As Paul said to the Corinthians, to take the test. Make sure that you're in the faith. As for the false followers, the false shepherds is the idea. Verse 18 goes on. Is it too little for you to have eaten up the good pasture that you must tread down with your feet the residue of your pasture, and to have drunk of the clear waters that you must foul the residue with your feet? And as for my flock, they eat what you've trampled with your feet. They drink what you have fouled with your feet. You might remember that the earlier judgment, his proclamation, was that they were uncaring, they were selfish, they did all these things for themselves and not for the sheep of Israel. Well, that's emphasized again here. They took the best for themselves, and whatever was left, they trampled even that down. Whatever was left behind, they ruined that, so it wasn't good for anybody else to use. Verse 20, therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, behold, I myself will judge between the fat and the lean sheep, because you have pushed with side and shoulder, butted all the weak ones with your horns, and scattered them abroad. Therefore, I will save my flock. They shall no longer be a prey, and I will judge between sheep and sheep. You know, my first instinct when I glance at this, because I was the overweight kid growing up, I was the one bullied and pushed around. I said, well, the fat kid, that's got to be the protected one. That's the bullied one. That's not the case here, okay? The fat kid, the fat sheep, they're the bullies here, and they're pushing around the leaner, weaker sheep is the idea. These bigger sheep, they're using their weight to throw others out of the way, you know. The idea is like literally throwing their weight around. They were abusive leaders towards those who are weak, but God says he would save them. Not only would God judge the bad shepherds, but he would personally establish a really, really good one. Look at verse 23. I will establish one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, my servant David. He shall feed them and be their shepherd, and I, the Lord, will be their God. And my servant David, a prince among them, I, the Lord, have spoken. So who is the shepherd established by God? It says here, David. Now there's a couple of different thoughts as to who this actually is. One thought is that this is the literal historical King David, resurrected to lead his former nation during the days of the millennial kingdom. Now, obviously, we know the New Testament saints won't be the only ones resurrected on the day of the resurrection and the rapture. We're Old Testament saints and New Testament saints resurrected at that time, including King David, right? So although Jesus is going to reign as king over Israel, it doesn't seem too unlikely that David would, you know, serve as a prince, also give leadership to the people during the millennial kingdom. That said, is that who God refers to here? And some scholars say yes, but it seems more likely that this is a reference to the Lord Jesus himself. You know, we talked about that parallel passage prophecy in Jeremiah 23. Well, in that place, God spoke of raising up a branch of righteousness to David who would be a king, Jeremiah 23, verse 5. So in other words, it wasn't David who would be raised, but a new king in the lineage of David. And this is the same descendant. We know that God promised to David this one that his throne, his kingdom would be established forever, 2 Samuel 7:13. So this would be a reference to Jesus, the son of David, the greater than David, but the servant of God. And you know, Jesus, he talks about himself in the same way. We know this very familiar from John 10, 14 through 16. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. There are other sheep which I have which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring. They will hear my voice, and there will be one flock, one shepherd. And when you think about that list of everything that the evil shepherds did and did not do, Jesus does the opposite. Where the false shepherds fail, Jesus succeeds. He selflessly lays down his life for the sheep of God. He seeks them out. He doesn't scatter them. He brings them together. Even when they reside in different flocks, Jews and Gentiles together in one church, one people, one body of Christ. Of course, this is what is promised to the Jews during the millennial kingdom. They'll see Jesus in that way then. But this is a relationship that we as a church, we enjoy this right now. It's a blessing. And I lied earlier. I said that was the last section. That's not the last section. The last section starts in verse 25. And it's a covenant of peace. Verse 25 says, I will make a covenant of peace with them and cause wild beasts to cease from the land, and they will dwell safely in the wilderness and sleep in the woods. I will make them and the places all around my hill a blessing. I will cause showers to come down in their season. There will be showers of blessing. Then the trees of the field shall yield their fruit. The earth shall yield her increase. They shall be safe in their land, and they shall know that I am the Lord when I have broken the bands of their yoke and enslaved, and delivered them from the hands of those who had enslaved them. So all the curses that were brought on by Israel's breaking the covenant, all that would be reversed in this new day. All of it would be renewed in this day. And more than that, besides being restored to their old covenant, they have a new covenant, a covenant of peace. Berit Shalom, all right? Covenant of peace. More than an absence of warfare, Shalom refers to a complete wholeness, a soundness, a prosperity. Everything that was wrong is made right all through the work of Jesus Christ. A covenant of peace. By the way, that statement, that's a great summary of the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation. Everything that goes wrong is made right through the work of Jesus Christ. That's what the entire Bible is about. And the process, it says, when Israel knows Jesus in this way, they know him as their Savior. They will understand their freedom from slavery, and they will recognize the Lord as their God. Now, question. Because we know that the Israelites were brought back from Babylonian captivity. Was this a promise for the people of Ezekiel's day, or was it for the future when they would be brought back into this new covenant, this new relationship? Well, it's really for the future. This spoke of the millennial kingdom. Now, God did bring the Jews back after the days of Babylon, brought them back, regathered them in Israel, the land. But much of what was written here in verses 25, really through verse 29, which we haven't gotten to yet, much of what was said there could not be said to apply to the nation during that time. Israel was back in the land. Jerusalem, the city, was repopulated. But it didn't have this level of blessing, not once. It didn't have this kind of shalom, peace, wholeness, fulfillment. No, these are descriptions of the future kingdom when Israel finally sits under the rule of the Lord Jesus, recognizing him as the Lord their God. I'm talking about that description going on, verse 28. They shall no longer be prey for the nations, nor shall beasts of the land devour them, but they shall dwell safely, and no one shall make them afraid. I will raise up for them a garden of renown, and they shall no longer be consumed with hunger in the land, nor bear the shame of the Gentiles anymore. You know, so many of the prophecies against Israel had the focus of them being humiliated in the sight of the Gentile nations around the world because they're going to serve as an object lesson to the world of what happens to a nation that disobeys God, breaks its covenant with God. And God says, even that is going to be reversed. Even their shame is going to be removed. We talked about last week, our sins being removed for us as far as the east is from the west. Even the shame is taken away. And it's like the promise we see in Revelation 21:4. God's going to wipe every tear from their eye. They won't even have the shame of it in mind. Verse 30, then they shall know that I, the Lord their God, am with them, and they, the house of Israel, are my people, says the Lord God. You are my flock, the flock of my pasture. You are men, and I am your God, says the Lord God. So it all comes down to their covenant. All these physical blessings, the land being restored, the safety, all that would be experienced, why? Not just because of a covenant, that's the reason why, but there's something specific, a covenant relationship with God. They are God's, and God is theirs. Reminds us of Ruth's commitment to Naomi. Reminds us of the singer of the Song of Solomon to the bride and back another. I'm yours, you're mine. That's how God commits himself to Israel. You know, our relationship is similar. The New Testament puts it in marital terms. Jesus is the groom. The church is the bride. We're going to sit and take part in the wedding feast of the Lamb. It's all through covenant relationship. The salvation of God is found only in the covenant relationship of God. That comes only through Jesus Christ. So that's God as the good shepherd. We also see God as the avenger in chapter 35, and it starts off verses 1 through 9. It's a declaration of desolation. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, set your face against Mount Seir, prophesy against it, and say to it, Thus says the Lord God, Behold, O Mount Seir, I am against you. I will stretch out my hand against you and make you most desolate. I shall lay your cities waste, and you shall be desolate. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. And you say, well, where is Mount Seir? Mount Seir was Edom. And we have a little picture. You can see Edom way down there in the south. The nations, you might recall, had a long relationship with one another, Israel and Edom. The Edomites were actually descended from Esau, which is the twin brother of Jacob, or Israel. And like his more famous brother, Esau also grew into a nation, though not nearly as strong. They settled southeast of the land that was designated by God as a covenant land. And of course, that's an older map, but you can see where they were at least one point in time. The Edomites were regularly known to fight against Israel. At some points, they were actually dominated by Israel. They served as a vassal state to various kings of Israel. They would rise up in rebellion other times. No love is lost between these two nations. They were constantly struggling against them. Okay, they gloated over Jerusalem's fall to Babylon. We mentioned earlier that with chapter 34, there was a section earlier in Ezekiel where God had declared woe upon the leaders of Israel. Well, likewise, there was also an earlier judgment provided against Edom back in chapter 25, verses 12 through 14. Why would we see it all over again and really more in depth here? Well, just because something is said once doesn't mean it doesn't need to be said again. In fact, Edom, we're going to find when we get there, is the entire subject of the tiny prophetic book of Obadiah. All of it is in reference to Edom, mostly in a reference to these same events. And so in regards to this repetition in Ezekiel, it's possible that God is using Edom as an example. He's used Israel as an example. Well, why not use Edom as an example? In fact, we'll see this in the next chapter too. He talks here about Mount Seir. That's how it started off. Well, he's going to talk about the mountains of Jerusalem in chapter 36. So perhaps there is a difference between how God treats the Gentile mountains versus how he treats the Israel's mountains. God promises to judge his own people, bring them into restoration, but he's going to remove these other Gentiles who have come in and tried to take it for themselves. And that's kind of the idea through this chapter here, thus this repeated judgment. Perhaps they're standing in for the rest of the nations who tried to take advantage of Israel's misfortune. But whatever the case, Edom did deserve its own judgment, and God's using them to send a message, okay? By the way, the fact that Edom was left desolate, this is a prophecy that was literally fulfilled. And you say, well, I want proof of that. Well, okay, go out and try to find yourself an Edomite and meet him. Have lunch with him. You won't find one, right? The Edomites are gone. Today, the nation is really desolate. Even the most famous cities and ruins that are in the area, because Edom, as you know, as you can probably figure out here, is in basically in southern Jordan, kingdom of Jordan. Well, even the cities that were there, the ancient ones, they're all ruins today. And the cities that we have, most of the ruins there weren't built by the Edomite kingdoms. They were built by the Nabataeans who came in after the Edomites. The people that were known as the Edomites were by and large absorbed into Israel. We see them in the New Testament referred to as Edomians. But their cultural heritage was desolate. Their cities were laid to waste exactly as God said it would be. And the result is, as God says here, is that Edom would know that the Lord God of Israel was the one who did it. And so this famous refrain that we've seen throughout Ezekiel, we see repeated here, and you shall know that I am the Lord. The Gentile Edomites would have no doubt of the power of the God of Israel. Let's pick up in verse 5. Because you have had an ancient hatred and have shed the blood of the children of Israel by the power of the sword at the time of their calamity, even when their iniquity came to an end. Now stop there. Edom had a long history with Israel. It's filled with enmity. They had this, God says, ancient hatred between them. And this ancient hatred was Edom's undoing, because ultimately this falls under the curse of Genesis 12, verse 3. Say, where's a curse in Genesis 12? Well, it's in the same blessing that God gives to Abraham. He says in Genesis 12, 3, I will bless him who bless you. I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. You might recall God gave Abraham a land. He gave him a covenant promise. And all the families of the earth would be blessed because Abraham had faith in God. He had followed his call and obedient. The ultimate result of that obedience is the birth of the Lord Jesus. And he blesses all the earth. So there's that messianic promise. But before there's a personal promise of protection given to Abraham. To those who blessed him, they would experience the blessing of God. To those who cursed him, to those who cursed his descendants, would be cursed. And that's what happened with Edom. They consistently cursed Israel, fighting against them at every opportunity. And so now it's time to reap the consequences. They had cursed Israel long enough, and now God would rise up and act. And it shouldn't need to be said, but it does need to be said, that this promise is still in effect today. This is a perpetual promise of God to Israel. Those who bless Israel will be blessed. Those who curse Israel will be cursed. And nations as a whole would be wise to act in Israel's defense. And that doesn't mean we need to be apologists for every single action that the state of Israel takes, because as a nation, you know, they're a secular nation. They're still rebelling against Jesus, the Messiah, of course. But we do have the choice as the people of God. We can act in Israel's benefit, or we can act towards their detriment. And I would pray that God would guard our nation from making foolish mistakes regarding foreign policy when it comes to Israel, because this promise is still very much in effect. Anyway, let's move on. Verse 6. Therefore I live, as I live, says the Lord God, I will prepare you for blood, and blood shall pursue you. Since you have not hated blood, therefore blood shall pursue you. Thus I will make Mount Seir most desolate. I'll cut it off from one who leaves and the one who returns. I will fill its mountains with the slain. On your hills and in your valleys and all your ravines, those who are slain by the sword shall fall. I will make you perpetually desolate. Your cities shall be uninhabited. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. And you say, well, that's a lot of blood going on in the first few verses here. Scholars, some scholars at least, believe there's a bit of wordplay there, because the Hebrew word for blood and Edom are pretty close in sound. Blood is dam. And then Edom, so very closely there. And so perhaps God is underlying this bloody tragedy that's going to take place with Edom. But even if that's not necessarily the case, the idea is very violent judgment. The Edomites had not shied away from shedding blood themselves. They sought warfare. They sought Israel's destruction. So God would bring warfare to their doorstep. And he paints this picture of bodies filling the ground everywhere. You know, the people are decimated and the kingdom's destroyed. And we say, well, is Edom perpetually desolate? Well, yes, it is. Even though it's inhabited primarily by the Jordanian kingdom today, it's still desolate. How do we say? Well, because the Edomites aren't there. And again, their cities weren't rebuilt. Their culture is still destroyed. They did not experience the grace of God that, you know, the Israelites received when God brought them back in from their national captivity back to their national homeland. And they still had their culture. They still had their identity as a people. That didn't happen with the Edomites. So yes, they were perpetually made desolate according to the prophecy of God. And once more, this is evidence of God's existence. And that's the point he makes here. You know, when this judgment comes, when everybody's lying dead all around, you're desolate, then you shall know that I am the Lord. You know, this is one of the purposes of prophecy, even in the prophecies of judgment. When we see the word of God fulfilled, we know that the God who spoke it is the living God, because we can see the work of his hands with our own eyes. And this is just as true today as we look around and we see the evidence of fulfilled prophecy. Well, you don't have to go down very far. You know, Israel is once again a nation. Her enemies are lining up exactly according to God's word. And we'll get into more in depth than that when we get to chapter 38. The overarching culture of our time is engaged in apostasy away from the Lord, just as Paul said would happen in the latter days in his letters to Timothy. The more we recognize, fulfilled prophecy, the more certain we can be that the time of Jesus' return is very near. We know not a single thing stops him from rapturing the church today. Not a single thing stands in the way of him ushering in the great tribulation. So we need to ask ourselves if we're ready, if we see the signs of the times, are we prepared to see our Lord Jesus? And are we helping others be prepared as well? He goes on here in the last part of chapter 35 with his justification, why the judgment was coming. Verse 10, but you have said, these two nations and these two countries shall be mine, and we will possess them, although the Lord was there. We say, well, which two nations? Most likely this talking about Israel and Judah. Remember, it was a divided kingdom. Edom had seen the people removed from the land, and so they think the time's ripe to go in and possess this land for themselves. And what they hadn't counted on is that the land wasn't truly vacant. You know, Israel and Judah were gone, but God was there, and ultimately it belongs to him, and it's his to give out as he sees fit. And because he chose to give it as an everlasting possession to Israel, it is theirs forever. And I personally believe this is one reason why, you know, land for peace will never work between the Israelis and Palestinians. Number one, the Palestinian leadership doesn't really want peace. The founding documents that they have, that's still written down, that they hold to, still seek the total destruction of the state of Israel. But number two, the land is not anyone's nation, any one nation's to take or to give, because it belongs to God. He gave it to Israel. It's their inheritance. So it isn't up to any nation of the world, including Israel, to decide which parts belong to them and which do not. These are God's lands. He'll give it out as he sees fit. Verse 11. Enough political commentary for tonight. Verse 11. Therefore, as I live, says the Lord God, I will do according to your anger and according to your envy, which you showed in your hatred against them. I will make myself known among them when I judge you. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. I have heard all your blasphemies, which you have spoken against the mountains of Israel, saying they are desolate, they are given to us to consume. Thus, with your mouth you have boasted against me and multiplied your words against me. I have heard them. Now, when Edom boasted against Israel, what were they really doing? They were boasting against God. They dismissed the promises that God had made with his nation, and so they dismissed God. They discounted God entirely. And he's saying they're going to learn very different. And God does hear the boast of our enemies. Sometimes people wonder, why is there so much injustice in the world? How come so many people are hating God and they're getting away with it? How do they get away with it? God lets them get away with it. Well, he doesn't. And we've got to break out of a short-term perspective and get our long-term perspective glasses on. Because eventually every single person will stand before God for judgment. And at that time, no act of evil will go unanswered. No boast against God, no act of blasphemy will be overlooked. No sin of any sort will escape his attention. God is, of all judges, the most thorough. And he's absolutely righteous, and no one is ever going to, quote, you know, just get away with it. Which is good news for a lot of injustice that we've seen. It's also one more reason for us to be thankful for the cross of Jesus Christ. Because when we place our faith and trust in him, his sacrifice covered all our sins. His is not a half-hearted salvation, right? We are saved to the uttermost. And so not a single blasphemous word, not a lustful thought, not a hateful act, not any of those things are uncovered by the blood of Jesus. He died for it all. And so he saves us from all those things. Verse 14, thus says the Lord God, the whole earth will rejoice when I make you desolate. As you rejoice because of the inheritance of the house of Israel was desolate, so I will do to you. You shall be desolate, O Mount Seir, as well of all Edom, all of it. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. So Edom's boast was evil joy, and God says he's going to turn it to grief. And once more, when they saw God in action, they would know it was him, and they would give him the credit for it. They would not worship God, but they would know he exists, and they wouldn't be left without any excuses. So God is a good shepherd. He's a mighty avenger. And you say, how do those things go together? Well, it all depends on the relationship, right? Those who love God, well, for those people, God lovingly seeks them out, and he saves them. He feeds them. He cares for them. He protects them. Those who hate God and those who act hatefully towards his people, well, God rises up in vengeance, and he judges them as they deserve. On both counts, it's really the love of God in action, because his love for us lets us experience his grace, and his love for us motivates his protective vengeance towards others. That's what he promised for Israel, and that's what he promises us as New Testament Christians as well. Of course, the issue then becomes whether or not we're in the love of God. If we know Jesus as our good shepherd, if we've responded to his loving call of salvation, and if so, then that means we can rest easy. We can lie down in green pastures. Because, yes, there are enemies in this present day. There are enemies on the horizon. There are enemies, spiritual enemies, Satan himself, that roars like a lion, seeking whom he may devour. But our God is powerful, and he will take care of them. Vengeance is his, and he can be trusted. So in the meantime, we live for his glory in the present, and we look forward to the future. We can be excited about the eternity we'll spend with him in the future, even while knowing we're not there yet, but that day is coming. You know, for Ezekiel and his audience, they were still in Babylon, but they had the promise of what was yet to come. There is a day coming for us, too, that everything is going to change in the blink of an eye. And we'll see Jesus face to face, our shepherd and our king. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he's coming for us. And we can't wait. We look forward to seeing him, Lord. Look forward to being physically in his presence. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your Spirit, and I pray that you would fill us all, that we would truly know the presence of the living God among us. Help us live for you now. Help us be comforted by the fact that you are our shepherd, you are our king, and our avenger. We don't have to worry, we don't have to fret about the things of this world and the slings and arrows. We just need to rest in the protection of our Savior. Lord, thank you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.